whatsoever. And I just want to say thank you, thank you, thank you. I truly, truly do feel like I have family with you guys. I feel like we're building this little family on this channel, and I just want to say I'm grateful, grateful, grateful for each and every one of you guys. I was so encouraged, by you guys this weekend with the birthday love. I never knew the magnitude of the how do I put it into words, the magnitude of how much God is using this channel. I knew God was ministering to people, but not to the extent of what I received this weekend. A lot of you guys, you know, were so sweet and just letting me know how much this channel has blessed your life, and I was just overwhelmed. Like, I cried. I was like, God, like, I never thought, you know, that I would reach so many people, and I never thought that so many people would appreciate this channel, because I do understand that ASMR is not for everyone, and there's so many different ASMRs out there, secular and Christian, and you know, I'm still a very kind of new channel, but I never thought that I would have the support that I do with you guys. So just again, thank you guys so much for the birthday wishes. Before we start on our strategy number four of our FerVent book series, I just want to give you guys an update, if that's okay. As you guys all know, I go to Bible Institute, and if you didn't know, I do go to Bible Institute, where I am taking my first semester of a three-year course. And during the first semester, we took four courses. We did Introduction to the Bible, Foundation of Faith, the Pentateuch, and we just finished the New Testament survey. And I feel like the New Testament survey was the hardest. We learned about Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. We learned about the book of Acts. We learned about the book of Romans. And we also learned about 1st and 2nd Corinthians. And it was just so much, information. I was just so overwhelmed in the beginning. I'm also a crybaby. If I don't get an A on something, like, I get really frustrated with myself, because I am an overachiever, always have been. That's just my personality, and I want to excel in everything that I do. And I know that I can't be perfect, it's not that, but I put that pressure upon myself. Like, if I'm gonna do something, it has to be done right. I want to do everything in the spirit of excellence. That's why sometimes I'll record a video and I won't even post it up, because I am so nitpicky. Like, everything has to be done at 100% in my views, right? But I finished the first semester. I finished my final with an A. I was so proud of myself. And then today at church, my pastor handed out some certificates that I'm gonna share with you guys. So the first one is a certificate of perfect attendance. It's a certificate of achievement. This acknowledges me, and then I had perfect attendance during semester number one. And then the second one was super sweet. I was not expecting this. It's actually missing a signature, which is mine, because he wanted to surprise me, because I'm the student advisor for Bible Institute. So I help with grading, attendance, homework, emails, payments, everything, anything that my pastor needs, I do for him. So he gave me a certificate that says it's an award for a helping hand award, and it's just a certificate just to say thank you for all of everything that I've done as the student advisor. And if you can tell, it's missing a signature, because he wanted to surprise me, because I had to sign all of the certificates to acknowledge them for the students. But I thought it was super sweet. Again, I'm so grateful. I did not get the highest GPA for my class. Somebody beat me, down. So, and they've told me that this book has just been ministering to their lives. And strategy number four. Number four is your family. Your family. And it says fortifying the lives of those you love. Your family. Fortifying the lives of those you love. And before we start, we're just gonna pray, okay? And it says, let's pray. Go ahead and close your eyes if you can. Let's get comfortable as we enter into this book. Heavenly Father, I just give you all honor, I give you all glory, and I thank you for this opportunity that you've given me on this platform to learn more about you, to read your word, and to edify the spirits of those who watch and listen on this channel. Lord, I presented them to you onto your throne. May you cover them. May you protect them. Lord, may you guide them. May you speak to them like never before. And Lord, as we read this book, I ask you that you begin to open up our minds. You begin to open up our spirits to receive and to understand everything that you have for us today. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. And amen. If I were your enemy, I'd seek to disintegrate your family and destroy every member of it, every single member of your family. I want to tear away at your trust and unity and turn everyone's love inward and on themselves. I would make sure your family didn't look anything like it's supposed to, because then people would look at your Christian marriage, your Christian children, and see you are no different, no stronger than anybody else that God underneath it all really doesn't catch this. Change anything. That's what the enemy wants. My husband Jerry, and just a side note, this is very interesting. My husband's name is Jerry too. just throwing that out there. So God is speaking to me right now. It says, my husband Jerry and I, we've both readily admit, had a terrible second year of marriage. We fought early and often, long and hard. Two people so young with so little in the bank of shared experiences with which to accumulate much ammunition. Yet we still seem to find plenty of it to go to battle with. And battle we did against each other all the time. Side note, this is so very true. At least in my situation, I've been married for 9 years, and this year we celebrate 14 years together. And let me tell you, we fought, and I mean we fought bad, but that's for another day, for another testimony. It says, but we made it through by the skin of our gritted teeth, and though the tough patches we endured once we settled back down only seemed to make us better, closer, more committed, more complete. 14 years later, look at God. 3 kids later, oh my God, this is me. Like, I have 3 kids. Like, this is God right here. We seem to be fully hitting our stride as a family of 5. Guys, God is good. God is good, and he's ministering to me right now. We still had stuff to deal with, of course, like everybody does. But for the most part, all good, happy, last year, with my family's blessing, I had accepted, much to even my own surprise, a part in a major faith-based film. I was shocked to be invited to participate, shocked that I was willing to risk saying yes, and shocked even more after the directors saw my acting abilities, that they still wanted me to take the role. Took me about as far out of my comfort zone as this girl has been in a long, long time, maybe ever. The movie, as you probably know by now, is on the theme of prayer. The power of strategic prayer, the kind of prayer power God can activate in his people, and specifically the kind of prayer that can rescue a family before it careens off a cliff of near certain destruction. The directors of the film wrote me a long email before shooting began, filling me in on details to help me prepare for what was ahead. And among their many notes was a warning. They wanted to make me aware of Satan's penchant for targeting the people who'd be involved in their previous films, and how he'd taken aim at the areas of their personal lives that were connected to the message of that movie. And that movie was powerful, powerful, powerful. It says, since the particular project was on the theme of prayer and family, they encouraged me to be vigilant about praying for my own family, praying against any assignments the enemy may have trained against us. Soon, summer arrived. We packed our bags and moved to another state to begin a couple months of filming. I was the novice on set, didn't know what to expect as far as all the acting and directing and movie making were involved, but even having been forewarned, I didn't fully realize how that summer of on-site shooting would affect some of the dynamics in my family. Gosh, we were just having fun in our new surroundings, soaking up the fresh adventure of it, not really thinking about the unique set of stressors placed on all of us. Being away from home, out of our element, out of our usual rhythms. But pretty soon the slightest things would set off a disagreement, a misunderstanding, hot feelings, short fuses. By the time we made it through our final wrap on the film set, we were exhausted, not just physically, but relationally. Okay, freeze here. Get this picture of what was happening in our family at that time, and how it contrasted with the message of the movie we were involved in portraying. Can't you see the enemy's strategy at work? Of course, he would want to turn up the background noise to try to complicate the work we were doing in expressing God's truth for a global audience. Of course, he would want, if possible, to water down this important message by dismantling the relationships of people participating in it, just as we've been told to expect. So since we knew who was behind the tension, we made the deliberate choice to stop fighting with each other and to fight instead with the doggone enemy. We vigilantly asked God to make our marriage and family, and the family of all those involved in the film, bulletproof against these incessant attacks. Too much was at stake. It was a big deal. But you know what? It's always a big deal. All of our marriages and families are a huge deal. Yours and mine. They are all that big of a deal, because each one is a billboard for eternal, unchangeable single woman thinking you might just flip ahead to the next chapter since this one doesn't apply to you, think again. There's more that pertains to you on this subject matter than you realize. We're all part of it, married or not, or just not married yet. We need everybody praying, even for a marriage like yours that may be still to come in the future. Here's why. According to scripture, the number one purpose of marriage, more than even the unique time-honored partnership it creates between a man and a woman, more than the conceiving and raising of children, more than any Prince Charming fairy tale in any little girl's head, is how it represents the mystery of the gospel in active living form. That's how a beloved professor of mine, Dr. Dwight Pentecost, who's also been a professor to my father decades earlier, said to Jerry and me in a typewritten letter that I still treasure in a keepsake box of wedding memories. I scarcely need remind you, hero, that marriage was instituted by God to be an object lesson to the world of the relationship of a believer to himself. Each of you will play a significant role in living out this lesson. A man chooses a bride, loves her, makes a covenant with her, and gives himself completely to her. The woman responds by receiving his love, surrendering to him, entering into his covenant bond with him, and becoming one flesh with him. It's not a perfect representation, of course, since the best marriage we can possibly make on earth still involves a pair of fallen, broken people. But its deepest sense, at its deepest level, this primary human relationship between husband and wife is meant to be a living witness to others of the love of Christ for his church. Marriage stands for the creation of unity among two people who were once separated in every way before love reached out and found the other. The way God reached out and found us and covenanted with us and loved us, and despite who we are, despite what we're like, still loves us. This image, more than almost anything, is exactly what the enemy wants to disintegrate. When scripture counsels husbands to love and lead their wives, even when it counsels us wives to submit to our husbands, the ultimate motivation for these lofty directives is not just so we'll get along better on the weekends, but that our home will reflect on earth the order of God's relationship with us. Husbands are to love their wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Wives are to submit to their husbands. Rebellion? Is it just all of you going to your own rooms disconnected? to be giving and receiving from each other. But is he the one on the receiving end of your frustration? Is he the one you're splattering with juicy comebacks spoken with disgust against the inside glass of your windshield while you're driving down the road rehearsing the script for your next altercation? Because the fact is, he's most likely the one who's pulled the wool over your eyes, fooling you with a crafty bait and switch, leading you to focus all your indignation on your man or your kid. Instead, he wants you miserable and exhausted and joyless and undone. He wants that picture of the gospel, the one you call your marriage and your family. He wants it tarnished, rippled up, smeared in the mud of failure, held up as fresh meat from the kill, churning you against each other and tearing everybody in half. As much as the Father loves and embodies unity, your enemy loves and embodies division. Wherever discord is present, he's never too far away. And as most of us sadly know from far too much personal experience, no wounds cut as deep or cleave us at the core of our existence more than the wounds we receive at the hands of our family. You better believe he wants a piece of that action. But maybe he wasn't counting on this. A woman who'd had enough to start taking some prayer action for her marriage, for her husband, for her children, for all of her family. So here we go. This is it. Bring your family issues right up to the line here. And let's get some stuff out in the open. Let's get specific. Let's put a bead on the bullseye where the real source of your family strife and discomfort and unmet needs are originating from. And let's show him the kind of resistance that a steady dose of prayer is able to exact against his demolition plans. Is it your marriage? Then quit trying to be the Holy Spirit in your relationship, responsible for poking and prodding that husband of yours until he finally sees the things the same way you see them. I'll admit, I spent some of my first years as a married woman convinced that my primary spiritual gift in life was to change Jerry. In Jesus' name. It's taken me nearly 2 decades to begin realizing I was wrong. Changing Jerry, as it turns out, is not my spiritual gift. Nowhere in 1 Corinthians 12 or anywhere else in scripture where the divinely infused gifts of God's spirits are listed, thus improving thy husband appear as even a footnoted selection. And if we didn't know this to be the case from its obvious absence among the catalog of spiritual gifts, haven't we all discovered from exalting experience that the Holy Spirit all by himself can do a much, much, much better job of it than we ever could? No, our job, my job, your job is not to change that man, but to respect him and then leave the rest to the Lord. Amen. Yes, Lord. When you do this, you're not letting him off the hook at all. You're leaving him to God. You're also well on your way to discovering something else. He's likely not the only one who needs to do some changing. In fact, he probably isn't the one, at least in my house, who needs changing. we have to change, because there's a lot of things that we don't think that need change, that do need change. That mouth, that attitude, the way you reply back. You're like, listen, God has changed me so much, and within changing me, I've seen the change in my husband. So I can definitely testify to that. And it says, the only effective way to fight in marriage is to pray. The way to see the real truth behind whatever's happening in this whole situation of ours is to pray. The way to get the wheels moving again that have clogged up or perhaps totally come off is to pray. Prayer is how we isolate the real problems, and prayer is how we get up behind those problems and attack them at the root. It's how we isolate the real enemy. It's how we keep him on his heels and off our man. And prayer is also how God gets through to us, even while we're praying for our husband, convincing us that maybe what our husband needs most right now is for his wife to become soft. Safe place for him to land rather than a breaking, nagging source of contention that only agitates him and makes things worse. She's slapping the mess out of us. So even if things were going pretty well for you right now, even if you don't have a lot to complain about or feel upset over, the enemy is still there, whether in full-on attack mode or lurking in the wait for the next possible opportunity to infiltrate. So pray, and pray fervently. paced the floor. I quoted scripture. I posted passages on the wall. I laid hands on the door spots and window ledges. And I'm not joking here. That was the last day my boy ever mentioned that man. As far as I know, he's never been bothered by it since, to that degree or in that precise way. Let the enemy run rugs shot over my kids? No way. And if I have a strong feeling, you won't allow him to do it either. An enemy is after your children. An enemy is after your children. I'm telling you, believe it, know it, but most important, deal with it by tunneling deep into your prayer closet and fighting back with every parental and spiritual weapon at your disposal. Is it an issue with another family member? Perhaps. Your most pressing family issues right now pertain not to your husband, not to your children, but to other members of your extended family who are unsaved, feeling the brunt of enemy attack on themselves, or who are participating intentionally or unintentionally with the enemy's design on you as their daughter, their sister, their cousin, their daughter-in-law, whatever. The form that these sorts of conflicts can take are as numerous as the number of people involved in them. But just as much as the devil loves stirring up trouble in churches, he loves stirring up trouble in families. He knows it's a Christian witness killer, an energy sapper, a time eater, a relationship destroyer. The amount of senseless hurt and distraction he can cause per square inch in your family is one of the most desirable economies of scale. He can do more damage with less effort by attacking us here within these relationships than in any other context. But if we're wise, we can use this, his own geometry against him, putting prayer into effect in places where we're close enough to touch the very people involved. Then as God does his work in us and in these situations, the others in our family, we will be standing close enough to watch it all happen in real time, to see the kinds of change and impact our prayers are able to accomplish. Again, if you are a single woman, don't think this chapter doesn't apply to you. If you're wise, you'll discern that it most certainly does. Praying for your mate shouldn't begin when you've walked down the aisle. It should start now, before you've been on the first date or even know his first name. Pray for the man God may be positioning as your future husband. Pray that he'll be set ablaze with love for Christ and a heart for leading you well and making your marriage a devoted priority. Pray that God would guard his friendships and those who will influence the path he is taking even right now. Pray that his passions will be attuned with an authentic faith, that his purity would be a matter of deep commitment, and that God would superintend the circumstances that bring the two of you together, all in his perfect plan and his perfect timing. If you don't have children of your own, pray for the little ones, nieces, nephews, neighbors who are in your life and whom God brings specifically to your attention. And yes, begin praying now for the child or children he may entrust you to have at a later time, to whatever means he leads to take. I once knew a guy who began setting aside $100 a month for his children when he was in his mid-20s, and he didn't even marry until he was in his early 30s. He was preparing nest of security in advance for his child to be born into. Prayer allows you to do the same thing in the spiritual realm, to prepare an environment of spiritual security and the first stirring of a family legacy before your child is even stirring in the womb. Can you imagine a gift? Can you imagine what a gift it could be years from now for your children to see your hand written fervent prayers? Fervent prayers for them before they even took their first breath. The family is one of the key access points of God's purpose on earth, and your family at the point of your sphere or influence is a major component of what he is doing right here where you live. In order to make sure you're fully cooperating with him and with the enormous opportunity embodied in your family structure and its people, they need you to not be on their backs, not be up in their faces, but be down on your knees, assume in you, fighting. Position. And this is the end of the chapter. What we have left is just some Bible verses and a call for prayer. So since I always pray, I'm not going to read the call to prayer. And I'm actually going to just lead us in prayer. So as we finish this, I pray that you were blessed. I pray that you were blessed by strategy number four, with the subject of your family. It is so important for us to be praying for our family, our children, our nieces, our nephews, our future spouses, because the enemy is out to kill, steal, and destroy, and we need people who can get into position to fight. So I'm just gonna pray over you. I'm gonna anoint you right there. Heavenly Father, I just come before your presence, Lord, in the mighty, mighty name of Jesus, and I present to you the listener and the viewer right now. I present to you their family. Lord, I ask you right now for a hedge of protection against the enemy over their children, over their spouses. In the mighty name of Jesus, Lord, I declare unity in the home. I declare unity, trust, communication, respect. Lord, I ask you right now that you give them the strength that they need to deal with their current trial and tribulation that they may be facing at home. Lord, I declare, Father God, that anything that is not like you in their home has to go in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, I am declaring, Father God, that your angels are being dispatched right now to their homes, that you will cover them. Lord, that whatever that enemy wants to send their way will not prosper. We cancel every attack of the enemy right now. Every plan, every decree, we send it back to the pits of hell. And Lord, I present to you every single person on this video, that you may prepare them for their future spouse. Lord, that you prepare their minds, their bodies, their spirit. Lord, I am declaring that they are praying for them right now. And God, I just thank you for their life right now. I thank you for what you're doing in their life. I thank you for the testimonies that are arising. I thank you for rest. I thank you for rest, Lord, because they need the rest. And I thank you, Lord, for every single thing that you are doing in their lives, in the mighty, mighty name of Jesus. Jesus.